If you spend any time on Twitter, you understand that not only is Twitter an absolutely wonderful resource for news and opinions and all kinds of things, but it is also an absolute hellscape. Twitter can be both, and it is both. You see a lot of fighting, you see a lot of agreements, you see new friends, you make new enemies, all kinds of things. I have Ben Dixon with me right now, the host of the Benjamin Dixon Show, and Ben, you've been talking a lot recently on Twitter, pointing out some of the, I guess you just could just call it ridiculousness, because we still have two sides that almost want to relitigate 2016 every day. I mean, this is kind of crazy, isn't it, at this point?
Yeah, I mean, listen, no one was more entrenched in the 2016 battle than me. I mean, that's when I came onto the scene. But honestly, it's an entirely different world right now. 2020 is entirely different than 2016. And what we're facing, particularly with Donald Trump in the White House and this renaissance of fascism is what I'm calling it, we can't afford to relitigate 2020 over and over again to the point where no one from Camp A is going to be able to support anyone from Camp B if they didn't win the primaries. That's what we have to avoid.
Yeah, and we do see a lot of that. I mean, you know, you see it in comments. You know, I'll never vote for X, Y, or Z. I'm only voting for this person. And it does go both ways. I've seen plenty of Bernie people who say that. I've seen Kamala people who say it. I've seen Buttigieg people who say this. So you can't obviously pin this on just one side.
Absolutely.
And I think a lot of people do try to do that because they try to say, no, it's only the Bernie people.
Yeah.
But really look around and you can see this with everyone. And that's the problem. You know, everybody's got to understand, hey, we truly are on the same side. I understand you got a person you prefer, but let's unite against the actual enemy instead of worrying about Susan Sarandon versus Deborah Messing right now.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the level of pettiness, right? The level of pettiness that has come out, particularly from some pretty popular media personalities, to be quite frank with you, like people who make extremely good money to do this, behaving almost like high school cliques. But the problem is like, you know, it's not that I'm trying to grandstand and say, you know, I'm better than you because I'm above this, but it's that we saw what happened in 2016 and we saw the divisiveness that lasted beyond 2016. And that type of divisiveness is guaranteed to give Donald Trump an advantage. And I'm sorry, there's just not enough space between, let's say, a Bernie Sanders and an Elizabeth Warren for us to wage a scorched earth battle where if Elizabeth Warren gets the nomination, nobody who supported Bernie is going to support her. There's not enough space when you compare them to Donald Trump. Heck, there's not enough space between Buttigieg and Bernie Sanders once we compare them to Donald Trump. And it's like we absolutely have the right to disagree and to argue about policies. But keep in mind, we're going in the opposite direction so long as Donald Trump is in the White House. So if you want Medicare for all, you're going to get far less than that if we allow Donald Trump to remain.
Right. You're going to get Medicare for fewer if this guy stays in office. He's already made it clear that his second term project's likely going to be gutting these safety net programs, Social Security, Medicaid, and Medicare. So we're going to end up with even fewer people with health insurance if this guy gets reelected. And so there is, you know, to an extent, there is obviously some good that can come out of people having debate, right? You know, my candidate is better. This person is better because of X, Y, and Z. And your person, you know, says this. So that gives me cause for concern. See, that opens up the door for other people to come in and say, well, hold up. No, I disagree with you. And those disagreements during these primaries, those are fine. But when you do reach that level of I refuse to listen to you, I refuse to vote for your person because of you, I mean, that reaches a whole level of pettiness. I'm willing to burn down the country because guy was mean to me on Twitter. I mean, come on.
Yeah. So this is a technique that I know conservatives use, right? They take the very worst of any community, the worst example that they can find, the outlier. And if they can't find one, they'll make up one, right? And then they use that as a representation for the entire community. For example, With the welfare queen. I don't know if anyone has ever found an actual welfare queen, but Ronald Reagan successfully lifted that up as an example to categorize anyone who uses welfare, and they subsequently were able to attack it over the following 40 years. This is exactly what we see left-leaning Democratic consultants and media personalities doing by saying, oh, this random Joe Schmo on Twitter says something horrible, and he is a representation of all of Bernie Sanders supporters. And I'm like, if we're going to use that technique, keep in mind we can do the same thing to you, right? And before we get into the tit and tat, we have to realize the ramifications of this, of these kind of actions, right? We're going to divide ourselves to the point where I simply don't like Elizabeth Warren because this one individual on Twitter said something, and it's almost like Brett Stevens. I don't know if you cover that yet, but Brett Stevens got mad over somebody with 9 likes and no retweets, and now it became this huge thing. Well, we have the potential of doing the same thing in this Democratic primary.
Well, and it's also reminiscent of Devin Nunes Cow Twitter account. You know, he made a big stink about something that nobody even noticed. And now you've got this Twitter account that's actually more popular than Devin Nunes. When you amplify it, when you give it the voice, you legitimize it. And that also creates a bit of a problem. And so I guess part of the thing is, like, don't get sucked into it. I cannot tell you, and I'm sure you're probably the exact same way. I delete probably 100 times more tweets than I actually send out. Because I'll sit there, I'll get angry about something, I type it out, and I'm like, no, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. And I wish more people kind of had that mindset. It's easy to get drawn into an argument, but really, at the end of the day, it's not worth it.
Here's the gag, right? Here's what's actually happening underneath this. Normal people would do exactly what you just described. But what's going on is that there are career opportunities. There's money. There's an opportunity to move up if you become a solid, let's say, if you solidly oppose Bernie Sanders, there's a career path for you, right? There's money that's involved. There's writing opportunities. And so people intentionally get on Twitter to do just that. And the same thing, like you get on Twitter to oppose anyone but Sanders, right? There's a huge audience that you can benefit from if you become the super Saiyan of Sanders supporters. I honestly didn't plan that alliteration, but it worked out, right? And so there's like tens of thousands of people who will start following you immediately because they need that kind of champion on social media. So people are doing this as a performance. It's very performative, and they're doing it intentionally. And there's one other group I want to keep you your audience aware of. There are Donald Trump supporters who are disguising themselves as never Bernie or never Warren, and they're doing it intentionally to divide us. And you can see that more and more and more. They can't really disguise their language that well, but I've seen more and more people that I'm like, okay, this is obviously they're a real person. Like, I'm not saying they're a Russian bot or anything like that, but what they are, they're operatives that are there simply to divide us.
And I think another big point of this is with Bernie and Warren, because we saw earlier this week, you know, you had that New York Times piece come out, and I saw a lot of people, a lot of friends on Twitter who were tweeting out this New York Times story about Elizabeth Warren, essentially saying she wants to kind of rebuild the Democratic Party infrastructure from the inside. And they took it and they're tweeting it out saying, see, she's establishment. She wants to, you know, work with the party elites. But when you read the article, it says, no, she's just telling them, listen, I'm going to help you. I'm going to fundraise with you. We're going to do these things, but we're going to do it my way, basically. Whereas, right. You know, and it also mentioned in the article, Bernie is the opposite. He says, listen, we had to get rid of what we got and we got to start over. And neither approach is necessarily wrong, but they're miscategorizing Elizabeth Warren in a lot of ways. And I've said repeatedly, Bernie right now is at the top of my ticket. Elizabeth Warren is a very, very close number two.
Yeah. But yeah, it's the same for me.
Yeah. And I have to defend Elizabeth Warren far more than I have to with Bernie, because unfortunately you do see a lot of poison out there mischaracterizing things that she has said and done, implying that in some way she's some kind of secret corporatist when there's nothing in her history that would ever suggest she would rule for corporations over the people.
You know, if we had to, if we're, Bernie is my first pick, just like you. Elizabeth Warren is a close second. It's because I believe Bernie would go in with a wrecking ball and try to accomplish what is on his agenda, right? I think Elizabeth Warren would not go in with a wrecking ball, but she has an agenda that will move the ball forward. Now, just because he goes in with a wrecking ball doesn't mean he's going to get anything more done than Elizabeth Warren would with her strategy from working within the existing apparatus. That's my view of the two of them. Neither one of them are so different than the other that I'm willing to go to war. I do not. I'm honestly, this is where I am. I used to be like the King Bernie bro, right? However you want to describe that, that was me. But I just don't believe in politicians anymore. I don't really care. I have no more affection or affinity towards Bernie Sanders than I do Elizabeth Warren. All I care about are the policies. And whoever is going to champion the policies that I want, that's who I support. And that's the extent of it. What we have going on is an obscene amount of cult of personality that's driving this. Like, people are just in love. They are enamored with Bernie Sanders. And I get it. I totally get it. But at the same time, like, you know, Bernie's only going to be able to accomplish so much. So what's going to happen in 4 years after Bernie is president and he can't accomplish like 50% of what he promised you? You're going to be disillusioned. You're going to be distraught. You're not going to want to participate. But you have to understand how this system works and not attach yourself to the personality of a politician, but attach yourself to the policies of the politician.
You know, that's something Mike Papantonio here from Ring of Fire had been talking about. You know, as far back as during the Bush administration, he said, you know, when you tie yourself to the person, you know, or you tie yourself or tie your religion to a politician, political party, it rises and falls with that politician.
Absolutely.
So when something happens to the politician, when they retire, when they get, you know, mired down in a scandal, your belief in everything falls with them. So mm-hmm. put it in ideals, you know, yes. Put it in goals. And I agree with you on the cult of personality. And we do have it. Again, this is something that really does cover the board. And I see it a lot. And I'm going to, you know, probably get hit pretty hard on Twitter for this. The Yang Gang.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. Like, I don't even think, like, the only one you could remotely compare to Bernie Sanders' cult of personality is the Yang Gang, for sure. And then I think Tulsi's crew would be a close third to that. And I get it. Like, it's very, especially with someone like Bernie Sanders, he's been fighting this fight for his entire life, it seems. Like, he's been fighting it longer than most of us have been alive. And so it's very easy to get lulled into that whirlwind of the Bernie campaign and feeling the burn. But at the same time, like, that drives the online pettiness. And I'm not saying it doesn't drive it from the Bernie side. It's when people see your fanaticism. That's what gives the Yang Gang or anyone else who opposes Bernie Sanders or the establishment, that's what gives them their fire. That's what they have this. That's how they created the Bernie Bros in the first place. But you strip that away from them and argue policy. Forget about Bernie as an individual. Argue his policies. And then they'll find themselves, the establishment will find themselves not fighting against Bernie Sanders, which is easy to do. They'll find themselves fighting against Medicare for All, which is a lot more difficult. Have them fight you based on the policies, not the personality.
I think that's a really good point to make, especially because, look, Bernie, it's kind of obvious. You know, the campaign slogan is not me, us.
Us.
You know, even he is like, hey, Let's do this together. Don't, you know, I'm not this savior guy. We're going to fight and we're all going to fight. You know, don't just say that Bernie's going to fix this. No, we're going to get active. And more importantly, we're going to stay active. Yeah. This is not a campaign. This is not an election. This is a movement that we're all going to be a part of. And to an extent, I feel like Elizabeth Warren is almost the same way. And honestly, I do have to say, if Elizabeth Warren had jumped in the race in 2016.
Yeah.
Bernie would not have run. He would have thrown his support behind Elizabeth Warren, I believe. And I think you and I would be having a much different conversation, not just today, but likely every day on our shows. we would be having different conversations. But, you know, so that was a big disappointment that she did not run in 2016. I am glad that she is in now, even though, again, Bernie's my top. I think Elizabeth Warren has awesome ideas. I think she has detailed ideas. And I think a Bernie Warren ticket is virtually unbeatable at this point.
Yeah. And that's the thing. Like, we have to keep in mind, that's a very real possibility. I mean, a Bernie Warren Bernie, like whoever's going to be the headliner, we'll see that's really dependent. This is the last thing about this that I think I want to make sure I point out. It really boils down to now who's going to run the better campaign, who has a better infrastructure, who has more boots on the ground, who can get more people out to the polls. So it's not a reflection of America or the Democratic Party or the establishment. No, it's a reflection of who has better organizing skills, whether or not they're going to be at the top of the ticket. But there's a very real possibility that we'll have a Warren Bernie or a Bernie Warren ticket come 2020. And we cannot undermine that possibility by being so petty right now.
You know, we caught a bunch of flack in 2016, and I'm sure you did too, because even after Hillary became the nominee, when a story came out that was unflattering towards Hillary, we still talked about it. You know, we reported on it, and people said, "No, you're destroying her chances." And you know, our response at the time was, "Listen, we're not cheerleaders for any particular candidate or party. If news comes out, we're going to talk about it because that's our job. That's our responsibility to our audience." And I think a lot of some of the nastiness we see online today, we still have a lot of holdovers who are looking to blame somebody. You know, we still get blamed. They still come after us and say, "You cost Hillary the election." You know, Susan Sarandon did. You know, whoever it is, David Sirota cost her the election. And we had Sirota on our program countless times. But that's not how it works. You know, we did not throw the 2016 election. We still, when we do these bad stories, we would say at the end, "But vote for Hillary because she's better than Donald Trump."
Yeah.
And I think people need to understand that, listen, sometimes our job here in the progressive media is going to be unpleasant. You know, we're going to have to say that, hey, this person we really like did a bad thing. You know, I personally like Obama. I think he's a good human being and I really like him. But when he screwed up, we had to talk about it. You know, sometimes we still have to bring up things like, yeah, he did a really bad job on this. But I always do make sure to point out, I like him as a person. You know, I have no qualms with him as a family guy, as a moral human being. I think he's great. And so I think people have to understand that, yeah, sometimes we have to go after these people. It doesn't mean we hate them. It doesn't mean that they're the worst person in the world. It just means, hey, here's a problem. You need to fix it. But, you know, anytime we do that, we get these mobs coming for us saying, "How dare you? You know, how can you say this? How can you trash this person's life?" And it's, no, we didn't like the thing they did here, and we're just telling you about that.
Yeah, and I think that directly ties into what we've been talking about, right? So, you know, if you're tied into the personality of the politician, then you're going to be hypersensitive about anything someone says. But if you're tied into the policies, then you're sober enough to be able to say, okay, they screwed up that policy, but they are the person who's going to get us closest to the other policies that we want. So that's how you consciously make the decision that, hey, Obama may have messed up on this, but he's still our best chance for that. Bernie Sanders, once he gets in office, he's going to mess up on this, but he's still our best chance to get that. Now, what I do want to say this to your audience, that what I'm saying now is rather idealistic, right? It is really wishful thinking. It's kind of utopian to believe that American politics can be based on policy and not personality. However, we have to start moving towards that, because the opposite is what we have right now. Everything is driven by passion. Everything is driven by anger, and everything is driven by the cult of personality. And if that's the extent of our political participation, then that is quite literally one of the reasons we have the system as we have it right now. And if we really really want to overcome the system as we have it right now, part of that calculus has to include moving away from policy and moving away from personality and moving towards policy.
That is absolutely correct. Listen, it's one thing, and I encourage people to debate policies and candidates on the left. Debate, not name called, not throw your Twitter account away and say, I'm never coming back because these people were horrible. Have spirited debate, but remember, the people we're actually fighting against, the people who do think it's okay to lock folks in cages, you know, to discriminate against other people based on, you know, the color of their skin or their sexuality or their religion, those people are the enemy. The people on this same side, we're getting a little ticky-tacky about, you know, who can enact a policy best. I'm glad we're talking policy, but we got to remember the people over there literally don't care if we live or die. And those are the people that we need to be arguing with.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Ben Dixon, the host of the Benjamin Dixon Show. Thank you very much for talking with me today.
Aaron, it's always a pleasure, man. Thanks for having me.
Not a problem. Thank you.